All right, let's go. Getting back in the groove. Let's talk some serious Destiny here. Birds, you ready?
Huh?
Birds?
Yeah. Hold on. I just gotta,
gotta
reply to this guy.
Are you tweeting right now?
Hold on. Yeah.
I swear, if you're tweeting.
Oh, it's gonna be a really good tweet. Hold on. Wait, is the show on?
Yes,
oh, what
we're
up,
about
everybody?
To do it.
It's your boy Famous Birds. Give me a follow, twitter.com/famousbirds. Yeah, I tweet now. Fire tweets day in, day out.
Yeah.
Woo, let's go.
Birds actually figured out how to use Twitter, and now he can't stop. So Swain and I are just going to do the show.
I love Twitter. Let's go.
At Swain_CR, how are you today, friend?
I'm doing pretty darn great, Bones_CR. How about you, Famous Birds, with the inconsistency?
Yeah, that's just at Famous Birds. Here's the thing about Twitter. I'm doing pretty good. I think I love Twitter now. I don't know why I waited so long. But at the same time, it's just this new thing I'm addicted to now. It's like checking my phone 100 times a day to see if I got like any immediate gratification of somebody clicking a heart symbol next to something I typed. Some new treadmill to be on. I'm good. And I'm ready. I swear. I closed the window.
How many tweets have you recycled in the past 24 hours?
I like to click the recycle button. I like to click the heart button. Sometimes I click left arrow if I want to say something back to somebody. But I will admit I'm still figuring out how it all works.
Welcome to Crucible Radio, the most serious podcast for Crucible. It's all about PvP. We take it very seriously and we love memes. But that part is
unrelated. That's our new year two intro. That's,
no,
that's what
not.
We're doing every episode now.
Your source for all things Destiny memes.
Oh, no, my God. That does not need to be a podcast.
All right, let's happen, baby. Let's go.
Oh, man. All right, so last week was our one-year anniversary. We have been, basically we haven't shut up about it for a long time. It was a cool, exciting thing, and it's still awesome that we have been doing this. I do want to say thanks to everyone who just, you know, expressed their appreciation for the show. That was incredible and very awesome. But I do really want to, just get back into the swing. We've got patch notes to discuss. We've got a very intelligent guest. We've got stuff happening.
Yeah. Thank you so much to everybody who has shown us some love. And just for listeners, thank you all of you just for coming along for the ride. I do want to say, we noticed that the t-shirts that some of our more graphically design oriented friends have put together seem to be pretty popular. So when you receive your Crucible Radio t-shirt, and we're waiting to get ours too, take a picture, send us a picture, send it to us on Twitter.
Do it.
Because you know that's where I am. I can't wait to see it.
Birds will instantly respond.
Yep. You're going to get that heart symbol immediately.
Crucibleradio.com/store.
Happy 1 year anniversary. Here's some patch notes and some changes, guys.
Yeah, some last minute patch notes in your face, ready to go.
And like always, when we get patch notes, it means someone's going to react angrily and furiously without even playing or experiencing what has actually happened. Luckily, we've had a couple days to play this patch.
Those few days were tough.
You know what? I was about to say you'd be surprised, but you shouldn't be surprised. I hope everyone goes back and listens to the episode we had John and Sage on and remembers when I got blasted for saying the doctrine sucked. Because I was not the only person saying that at the time. And I have learned from my mistake. Yes, at one point, the December patch dropped. I picked up my Doctrine of Passion. I didn't immediately get 10 kills. And I said, well, this still sucks. I'm going back to pulse rifles or whatever. And guess what? Now that's your favorite gun to complain about on the internet. Shocking how that comes out. I'm already too worked up about this. Let's talk about some awesome
read
notes.
You guys my favorite tweet that I've made over the past couple days.
God. Sure.
It's apropos. After this patch, I see no reason to play Destiny ever again, says man for the fifth time. Thank you, Fallout, for the Destiny onion. You know, we love this game. And I have to admit, I've been a-traveling. I had no idea these patch notes were coming and left right before they dropped. So I don't really know. But it seems like, balance-wise, a bit of a mixed bag. A lot of stuff came up. A lot of stuff went down. A lot of little changes. is it a whole new Crucible out there?
I mean, it's still fast-paced, at least to me, it seems, depending on the game mode. I obviously didn't get to try trials yet with it, but for the most part, you know, it's got the same look, same Crucible. It's just different people using different things. There's a lot of Grasp of Malix out there right now because Omnigul is the Nightfall, and everyone and their best friend is grinding that for the perfect role. So
yeah, I wouldn't go so far as to call the Crucible fast right now, but I will say that there are so many hunters in every game, which is great because everyone's feeling it out, and I love seeing people actively trying to explore different loadouts. Maybe they're just trying to gather clips on why their favorite build is broken now or whatever, but either way, they're playing, and I had some fun games this week. I have played on my Hunter a lot for the past two nights and can feel the changes, can say that I really like where Blade Dancer is at right now, just as a result of every other class being balanced, and we'll talk about that more in depth later. I do have to say, though, that hand cannons feel good. Mm-hmm. Hand cannons feel very good. I just like that they are a comfortable thing I can use and not feel, you know, it still exists. They still are a skill weapon. You know, they're still a challenge to use versus an auto rifle, which might be easier just because you can hold the trigger down. But I like that hand cannons now sort of feel like I'm not doing an exorbitant amount of work on top of trying to kill someone with this particular weapon. I've been playing with them a lot. It's not to say they were trash and now they're suddenly usable, but there was that extra work I felt of keeping a gun stable, you know, really, really trying to maximize range and all that and getting into some pretty intense 1v1s. And now they just, they kind of feel comfortable. I'm happy where they're at right now.
Yeah, for the most part, I'm looking at this like I have before. And I'm going to not overreact. I'm gonna take it all in for a little while, see where I end up personally, what class I play, what guns I keep around, all that. And then as it pans out, I'll have a better idea of what I think is a little bit overpowered, if anything has changed. It's always one of the best parts of balance patches, is just figuring out like what new thing amongst all of the changes is going to be fun to have around. Like it's always interesting when like a gun pops up out of nowhere and you're like, oh, that one's awesome right now. Let's go play with it. Mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of time before everything starts to level out and people feel out the meta.
How do your hammers feel, Swain, Mr. Sunbreaker?
Oh man. That's primarily what I've been playing the past few days is Sunbreaker. And it's got quite a bit of a change here. I did not expect this coming because they were like, oh, it's going to be about hunters. And they threw some Titan and some Warlock changes in there. But now, the hammer's feeling good, man.
This is interesting to me because it seems like the change is relatively small. The Hammer of Soul travel speed is up 1.3%. Seems pretty minor. The detonation radius is up 10%. Is that... you find a noticeable enough difference? Can you actually feel a difference in that?
So the loadout I play has been, since I took up Sunbreaker, has been Sun Charge and Tracking Hammers. And obviously Cauterize and all the other bells and whistles that come with a good Sunbreaker layout. But one of the things I found before the patch was that throwing a hammer as like a last ditch effort, say you're chasing someone down with your Sun Charge and you can't quite make it, throwing your hammer was always unreliable. You know, sometimes you'd hit them, sometimes you'd get lucky, but you definitely feel it a little bit better now. Like you're feeling it, the hammer travel a little bit faster, get to them a little bit faster, and kills that might have been, you know, a little damage here or there, are actual kills now instead. So I'm liking it. I'm going to stick with Sun Charge because that's one of my favorite play styles. But I am excited to be able to throw hammers a little bit more reliably now.
Well, I vicariously need to hear you guys talk about hunters. And let's get into that. But before we do, we saw some changes to a lot of the classes across the board, primarily it looks like super damage has gone up quite a bit. So, you know, for some of those that were kind of right on the cusp, like Golden Gun not being able to take down a Sunbreaker, completely pushed over the limit now.
Same thing with Striker too.
Mm-hmm. Same thing with Striker.
And Nova Bombs.
And Nova Bombs as well. Now, our friend Fallout had done a bit of research and confirmed that it still takes two Golden Gun shots to pop a Defender Titan bubble. Are there any other supers that are that you guys are aware of that are still not enough to do that there? Or have they all kind of reached that level where there's no question for sort of anything on the cusp?
Supers feel pretty super at this point. You know, everything kind of gets the job done.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like every super played very, very well. If you get your shot off, you're going to kill your target, which I think makes the most sense. They're still easy to destroy if you are not smart about it. You know, my switch to Blade Dancer, I'd been playing it off and on, but it's the first time I put a couple hours into just this class last night. And I got killed out of my blade a couple times just because I had to readjust of when to pop it. When how to approach that sort of thing, getting used to the new timer. So it's not as if suddenly anyone who presses both triggers at the same time is suddenly in for a breaker. But when you do connect because you hit your shot, it works, and that's a satisfying feeling.
I would say the one thing that I have had trouble with is escaping people's supers with mine when I have my Sun Charge. Because say I hear someone about to do a Fist of Havoc, I hear a Nova Bomb go off, or someone who's going to shoot an arrow at the ground near me, I have just enough time to Sun Charge and get far enough away to not be affected by whatever they threw at me. But the change to the Night Stalker has ended that. Specifically for going up against that class, they immediately take me out of the game and my Sun Charge stops. So it's looking pretty good from the other supers' perspective. It's definitely putting a wrench in my evade game.
Bones, have you had a chance to really explore the changes made to Sunsingers and to Voidwalkers?
I haven't played any Void. I plan on doing that a lot, and I was kind of saving it because I kind of feel like I want to get back into it. I used to be such a full-time Voidwalker that I was like, you know what? I think it's about time I return. But I did play some Sunsinger. And the Firebolt is not quite the monster that it once was. Whether or not that means switch entirely to stickies or not, I think requires a little bit more playtime, at least for me. Stickies are still very good. They do the job if you can actually aim them. I have a terrible aim with them, which is why I'm sticking with Firebolt for a little longer. I did notice that I had to really carefully place my shot because of that reduced radius by up to a meter. I definitely realized I had to put it right next to them, which made me a little more careful, where previously I might just run Void Fangs and toss them forever. I get that. They're easy to land. But when I did hit people, I got a group of three on a special crate, tag all three of them, and then they go down at range with a shotgun because they take extra damage and they're burning. That was awesome. I could just clean up rooms with that. So a well-placed Firebolt is still really awesome with Viking Funeral. The melee, I did notice the difference when you slap, and it takes a very slight difference in terms of when your flame shield will proc. But you know what? It's not so noticeable that I started losing every trade. Otherwise, with Voidwalkers, I'm just sad that Blink gets negative recovery because I feel like Blink is just not worth it now. It's like a shell of what it once was. I don't know why they hit that even harder, but I don't know. Glide is pretty okay. The focus burst on Sunsinger is what I'm comfortable with now, so I'll probably just stick to that on Voidwalker.
I will bring this up because we were talking about Sunsinger, but it looks like it's gone across the board for fire-based like tick damage, that it no longer ticks for 7, and it's ticking for 4. So that happens with my Sunbreaker, like whenever I get a melee off or whenever I get a grenade into a, you know, into a corner, it's not ticking for as much as it used to.
You know, I did see something though on Twitter about incendiary grenades not being as strong, which, you know, wasn't targeted specifically in patch notes, and people were like, wait, I thought it was just trip mines that get affected and swarm grenades. Grant McKay, who operates these subclass balances, did say that that did not seem right to him. Might be something they're looking into immediately. There's some few bugs they've got to fix with 2.3. It does seem like that is on their radar, though, because he acknowledged that on Twitter, and he was saying that incendiary should not have been affected. So, maybe solar grenades with burn effects are a little weak right now, but that could go up.
Yeah, we saw, I mean, we saw with, like, the changes that they made that not everything can work out perfectly. You know, they throw some bugs into the system, people show up invisible. Mm-hmm. A lot of people were reporting that. A lot of people were reporting that they couldn't even get their Guardian's light level. There was just a zero. So everything, you know, you change one thing, some other things show up as soon as it goes out to the masses. It's going to happen. So just, you know, go outside.
Real talk, though, before we go into Blade Dancers, Swain, what is Twilight like? Is it okay?
I mean, it's one of those things where I saw that the Night Stalker got their change, and that's the aside from Blink, it's the only other kind of like juke move you can do in the game, and I'm okay with it. It's going to take some time to get used to not being able to do the double juke, mm-hmm. because that's one of the best ways to like close a gap on someone is to do the double juke move, because it gets your momentum going really quickly. Or if, like, a lot of times, the things I had to adapt to when I was trying out other exotics was the fact that whenever I'm running fusion grenades, I will hit some, like, I'll get close to someone, make sure that I get it on them, and then juke backwards so that I am out of the radius of the explosion. Mm-hmm. And adjusting to that was tough. But, you know, it's just a matter of them they're not trying to take away my playstyle. They're trying to influence more of a diversity. So I may stick with Twilight Garrison because I do like the ability to do that one, even if it's just one. It helps out. And I may try out other exotics. I was running the feedback fence for a little bit, and I was trying out some armamentarium. So you'll probably see more diversity. You probably won't see so many people running the blue sweater vest.
And we have to be honest, that was the only thing you should have been using on a Titan for the longest time. Unless you're a member of the Force and you're using no backup plans on your Fun Police build. But I mean, otherwise, I hadn't taken off my Twilight since I got it.
I could see some people not being able, like, there's people out there that aren't familiar with Titan skating. They're not familiar with running a Titan to its max ability. So I could see someone who doesn't know Titans all that well not thinking Twilight's all that good and running something else. But it, for the most part, it was the go-to. Like, I swore that I would never take it off, and I didn't until this week.
I mean, I think that's one aspect of some of these balances patches that can be really frustrating for people. But, you know, we've had some of the people perform these balances on the show before, and we've heard time and time again, they don't want that to be the case. They don't want there to be only one perk, only one exotic, only one particular build or weapon that every player should feel obligated to lose, like Twilight Garrison had with Titans. And so a lot of these changes they make are for really to bring down either the effectiveness or just the overwhelming appeal of some of these really, really just universally good elements of the game. Whether or not you like that, you're welcome to your own opinion. But I do have to say it makes a certain kind of sense.
The only thing I'm upset about, Birds, is the fact that if I want to use a different loadout, I don't have other tier 12 exotics. So I'm sitting here, I'm like, I'm desperately looking for glass needles in my inventory. And I used them all on the feedback fences and didn't get the roll that I wanted. So back to step one here with making sure my loadout is great.
So we've been dancing around it. This is the one I'm most interested in. The Hunter class, every single one of the subclass saw anything from a medium to a pretty dramatic overhaul. I can't wait to go play it. I miss my PlayStation, but I'm going to have to rely on you guys. Where do you want to start?
Let's give a little bit of a forewarning here. We won't get too in depth with all of this because we are going to have some special guests next week.
Good point. Joining us on the show.
That is next week.
Let's go ahead and announce them. We'll be fielding questions. Joining us on the show, of course, our good buddy, John Wisniewski. But some names you might recognize now, Mr. Greg Peng, who did the weapons balance, and Mr. Grant McKay are going to be joining us on the show to talk through some of these changes. Let's get the obvious stuff out of the way, but get your nitty gritty questions ready and we can ask them next week. But initial impressions, I know you guys are still feeling this out. Where do you want to start? Bones, you've been talking about Blade Dancer.
Yes.
Blade Dancer is one that saw some of the most significant changes to really just some of the core operations of what it's like to play this class. And you're saying Blade Dancer's up? You're liking it.
I am liking it in comparison to Night Stalker. And Night Stalker feels goofy only because I've put the most time on it when I'm playing Hunter. I do think it got hit in a couple ways that make you really rethink your build and stuff like that. So I'm still figuring that out. Blade Dancer felt like, oh, I can do this, especially where I'm at personally in Destiny. It fits me. The biggest Blade Dancer changes were in grenades and the super. I'm not going to talk again about Blink, the negative recovery. I haven't been using it. I really like controlled jump. And a little bit about the melee. Apparently backstab might still be having problems. We can get to that too. But first thing I notice is skip grenades. And I had switched over to them for a little bit, especially when I would watch Crafty and he was just so good with them. And I was thinking, I got to do that. If I don't play Blade Dancer regular, I better do what he's doing. I actually recently switched back to Arc Bolt, and I've been using Arc Bolt on my Stormcaller as well. And Arc Bolts, I'm doing a little bit better with them. I also realized that I have Lucky Raspberry Year 2, and I kind of forgot that was brought up. And then I got that, and I was playing with that and having a great, great time in doubles and Inferno, just triple tagging them and stuff like that. When it comes to the super, I'm still getting used to it, but I can feel like it's a little more controlled. The damage just happens now, and that's awesome. I think that comes in with the melee fix from about a month and a half back. Definitely plays a part in just making Blade Dancer work, but the increased damage, the energy cost is a little shifted where I'm not so much just spamming Blade across a large space, but that also keeps me out of the air and I'm forced to maneuver more on the ground, which I found to be kind of fun because it's actually cool to see your Blade Dancer in third person running around. And I love sliding, activating it, cutting left and then like sliding again. And you can just zigzag around walls and stuff like that. The major thing that I am doing with Blade Dancer, and I'll just go over my loadout here, is not really the biggest part related to the change, but what I'm feeling good with right now. So I'm using Arc, like I said, with Lucky Raspberry, making that transfer to more enemies and have a little bit more range. Better control, Razor's Edge, obviously, so I can throw my super at length, which I love doing. It's like one of the cooler kills. I have been running backstab, but I've been trying out fast twitch because the range is down. It's taken down about half a meter. Not drastic, but it's noticeable. I used to use Blink Strike from so far out and be so comfortable finishing that shot. But then when I don't have that little jump forward in distance, I end up whiffing a lot. So I like the fast twitch to just have more melees. I'm using Hungering Blade, of course, on my super. I don't think that's totally changed, even though Encore is worth a look now. Big thing for me in Blade Dancer is fleet-footed, not quick draw. I have stopped using quick draw almost completely, and I really love fleet-footed with my shotgun.
It is probably worth mentioning. You mentioned Lucky Raspberry, which was one of my favorites from year one. In addition to increasing the range of the Arc Bolt, It also means that you spawn with a free grenade every time you respawn. Yes. You probably just didn't mention that because you don't ever die, and so you don't notice that part of it.
Not true, but yes, I did forget. And oh man, Lucky Raspberry is good. I know arc bolts aren't quite what they used to be with the old one-tap thorn arc bolt kill, but when they do chain, it's really awesome. It's really great to know you can push into a room and everyone's going to be at half health. But the reason I bring up fleet-footed is because I have been shotgunning more often than not. I'm still adjusting to my new scuff, and sniping is not going super well for me. But fleet-footed essentially adds knee pads to any shotgun you have. So say the quest conspiracy theory, or just a party crasher with aggro and rangefinder, I now have a slide that will carry me as far as knee pads. It's like a shotgun with four perks on it. And to me, that's been a huge, huge difference in my game. And just maximum sprint speed, that's really great too, because my game really relies heavily on positioning. It relies on disengaging and escaping and reapproaching from a new angle before anyone has a time to think, oh, I should check to my left. So that extra speed and then the slide distance for 1v1s, it's become one of my favorite perks, and it's definitely making me lean towards Blade Dancer just as a whole when it comes to hunters.
Well, I was so excited before we knew about this patch. The very last thing I did in Destiny before I left on this trip was to play some Blade Dancer, and I thought, you know what? I'm going to do the Blink Shotgun thing, even though you can't do it. I'm going to make it work, and it was a bit of a gut punch to see the classes change so fundamentally, literally the day after I leave. But you paint an interesting picture. I'm definitely looking forward to giving this a shot. You also mentioned Night Stalker, and that's one that you're familiar with. We saw a lot of changes across the board to some of the fundamentals of Night Stalker. Do you guys want to sort of go into that a little bit? In particular, I'm interested in the smoke. It seems like some pretty dramatic changes to the old fart cloud.
Yeah, I still not use that terminology, but there's definitely a difference. What happens is the impact doesn't sort of keep you tied to the ground. That's in terms of getting hit by a smoke, which is, I don't know, like in terms of getting attacked by a Night Stalker, that's not a good feeling in this game, you know? Just like it's not a good feeling to run around for miles while a swarm grenade or a skip grenade chases after you and stuff. Yeah. Getting stuck in smoke sucks because you're like already trying to react and evade and
can't save.
You're not trying to be stupid and keep fighting. You are trying to disengage and they keep you there. And, you know, the wombo combo may not be that strong anymore, but I don't know. That's weird because it was the use of two extracurriculars. So if someone uses a wombo combo, they don't have anything else to throw at you for a little while. But yeah, it was one of those things I didn't like getting touched by. So I'm going to say that I'm okay with that change. Spike grenade, though, I was using that a little bit. And that did get me some kills. Smoke, not so much. Spike grenade did actually help.
I will say this. All these people out there that are upset about melee changes when it comes to wombo combos and the knives, we'll get to the knives in a second.
Mm-hmm.
Just think about playing on a Titan where none of that matters.
Yeah, hey, hold still, buddy. Let me throw this thing at you.
They had it rough for a long time, real long time.
You can't even throw things. It's just
you could throw a grenade. That's something.
Right? I got that right. Okay, fine.
Well, Swain, you did mention it earlier. I think it's worth calling out again. There's a couple items that appeared in these patch notes that were really big wish list items from the community. The changes to Firebolt grenades and Viking Funeral, no surprise there. The change to Shadow Shot being the other one, very, very frustrating. I've mostly mained Night Stalker
noticeable
over these past couple months. Okay, so that's what I want to know, that when a Sunbreaker is coming at you and you go, this is it, I can shut him down, I can do my Night Stalker version of the Fun Police, and then he throws a hammer at you and doesn't seem to notice it until long after you're dead. this is a stark change, you're telling me?
I've definitely noticed it, and it may be because of the super that I use that I notice it a lot, but for the most part, It's pretty instant. You're going to have those moments where someone's going to still hit you with something because the internet is a complicated place, but for the very most part, it is instant. You are getting tethered and you are stopped in your tracks no matter what. And it's frustrating, but you know, that's part of what makes the Night Stalker build now. Night Stalker build is going to lean on that where it lost some things. So pretty good.
I'm curious to see how in Trials the usage of Night Stalker ends up shaking out. I mean, that's one situation where the super is not just, hey, let me pick up my three kills, but being able to use your super or shut down an enemy super can really change the flow of the game. It can really be a turning point. I'm curious to see if that's really enough of a difference there to have an effect.
Yeah.
I think the Night Stalker has been popular among a lot of big time players because it allows one person to do a lot. You know, it has so many options and stuff like that where people who play on stream or whatever, if they're big players, they do spend a lot of time playing by themselves, or they do spend a lot of time like helping other people to the lighthouse. So it's nice to have something that gives you a lot of choices. So where the Night Stalker neutral game goes down a little bit, forces it into a support scenario sometimes, you do have to rely more on your teammates. You now have a super that can be used a little bit more aggressively, or at least a little bit more reliably when you are playing defensive, and you can actually call out a push after your shadow shot because you know it will tag someone on time. Whereas previously you shot it and then just sort of wondered if the person would stay close enough for long enough to get stuck by it. So yeah, that's the ups and downs of balancing. That's literally it, right? It's taking the things that are used so much, tweaking them a little bit down, and taking the things that weren't as reliable, bringing them up a little bit. Same thing happened with gunslingers, although I feel like the reaction has been a little bit more drastic because, well, they weren't used a lot, and people thought maybe if they're not used a lot, they don't need a lot of attention. But, you know, we don't know the effects that an untouched gunslinger might have had if you did the same effects to Night Stalker. You know, so all of these changes that we're looking at, we always have to constantly keep in mind that they are happening in tandem with all these other things going on in the Crucible. And yeah, there's still stuff you can question, and there's still stuff where you can just be unhappy because that was your favorite thing. Like, I'm unhappy about plenty of changes every time these patches come out, but you got to start thinking about like, okay, so this doesn't seem so clear on its own if I zero in on this one line of a long, long list of patch notes, but maybe amongst this list, it has some other causes and effects around me. So maybe I can consider that.
Also, take into account what they're doing in this patch notes with Titan, especially the Sunbreaker. They tuned Sunbreaker back in September? Well, not September, in like November of last year. And, you know, it got brought down and it's not what it used to be, but it was fun. It was fun in the meantime, and now they're bringing it back up. So I wouldn't say that like this is dead. This is completely going to be gone from Destiny for the rest of eternity, because balancing and doing this job is pretty much a daily, like it's going to be happening all the time, and it's going and be appreciative that it's going to be happening all the time, because year one was tough.
Yeah, better some changes than 9 months of roughly the same meta.
Yeah.
I want to get back into this list. Let's hear about gunslingers. So we talked about the golden gun super increase. A lot of these perk changes, circle of life, chain of woe, over the horizon, scavenger. If you guys tell me that you've got these figured out, I have to assume you're bullshitting. This is some deep inside stuff here, and I kind of want to see how these play out over time. But that leaves two big changes. The changes to the grenades, in particular the swarm grenade, but the trip mine no longer being sticky and being 3%, but significantly weaker when you think about what that means. And also the changes to the throwing knife. Swain, you had mentioned the throwing knife. What comes to mind there? What have you noticed?
Well, the base damage has reduced by 10%. So I don't play Gunslinger and I don't play Hunter that often, but I've been paying attention to the community. I've been paying attention to how people are reacting to it. And I actually watched Holtzman playing with his gunslinger a little bit, and he seemed a little bit frustrated by it because the base damage being reduced by 10% kind of takes away some of its effectiveness. Whereas I think they kind of wanted to remove the burn effect from when you what's the one where you put it on your flaming knives?
Incendiary blade, something like that.
Something like that. But with that, you have to basically like run that now if you want the throwing knife to be like a one kill. So I mean, it's just another thing that people are used to. And it got tweaked to the point it's drastically different than it was before.
Yeah, one of those sort of core moves of the kind of career gunslingers is beginning an engagement with just a single shot from a gun like a hand cannon, but really a lot of guns, just a single bullet combined with a reliable throwing knife headshot is enough to equal a kill. I don't know how fundamentally that's changed, if that's pulled some guns out of that equation, so now it's more than one bullet from a lot of guns to do that. But I could definitely see that being frustrating, especially if you rely very heavily on throwing knives and you want to have the continuous throwing knife if you can reliably hit those precision shots with them.
Yeah. Titans. Yeah.
So the Tripmine one is interesting. I've not played with this. However, I've seen a number of clips of Tripmines where, and the get it off achievement, no more for Tripmine. Glad I got my montage clips already. I've seen a lot of clips where a gunslinger threw a Tripmine as if he were to stick it to them, and it doesn't stick to the player. It does bounce off of them. But as long as the player isn't moving particularly quickly, if they're stationary or if they're just not sprinting, a lot of the times it seems to fall to their feet and then pick up the kill anyways, or at least fully connect based on the target's armor amount. Have you guys, has this been something you've explored yet? I mean, the art of sticking a trip mine to someone consistently is already a pretty impressive skill if you have it. You know, I'm always surprised when it ends up working. What do you guys think about this one?
You know, I haven't used trip mines. I was messing around with the swarm grenades when I did play Gunslinger. The only thing I can look at when I read this patch note is that the three grenades that were specifically designed to stick people are now the most effective sticky grenades. Because it was funny that a grenade that only had that side effect was really the best sticky grenade to use. So now I'm just looking at it thinking, oh, yeah, that makes sense. It should probably go on a wall. And, you know, Fallout was saying you can still get a bounce off of someone, which results in a kind of hilarious spinning around of the laser, which can also definitely kill a person that you're aiming it at. But yeah, you can't use it as this direct, I will attack you in the face kind of throw anymore, which I guess that makes sense.
I'm still dying to them, so.
I'm still walking over them when I'm not looking down, and that's annoying.
Something there's working.
It's still an effective grenade. It's going to do its job every time, and if you're good with it, you're going to find ways of getting those kills anyway. So
yeah, it's about map control. It's about area denial, and in a game that's all about different approaches and finding special angles, you deny a player an angle, even if it's for half a second or a full second while they stop to shoot your grenade. It allows you to focus on different angles, and it allows you to slow up a player's momentum, and that's what a good, well-placed trip mine is really for. It's not for hitting them in the face and getting a kill.
Yeah, I would say,
as funny as that is,
a good comparison would be that the fusion grenades, like on the Sunbreaker and such, what if those bounced? What if those were like incendiary and they bounced? People would be upset that it had two uses.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So trip mines being removed from being able to stick to someone, that feels right to me, because I can't bounce a fusion grenade to get it to stick to you unless I'm like tagging your foot.
Maybe you're just being positive because Bungie pays you.
Yeah,
not enough.
Just getting those Bungie paychecks and those Casper paychecks. Look at you.
R.I.P. ads.
Well, We also saw some gun changes. These seem a lot smaller. Some ammo economy, a change to the fast-firing auto rifles. The counterbalance one is interesting. Actually, a great post on the playbook. In practice, it seems that this counterbalance nerf, if you want to call it that, is extremely minor. That's still a great go-to perk for a lot of guns. I just have one question. The last word. How crispy is it now? Is it
crispy? It's real tasty.
It's crispy and tasty.
It's delicious.
So really two changes here. Very frustrating bloom, especially in close range, having trouble with that accuracy, but also a change to hand cannon drop off. Are you guys feeling both of these effects?
I personally am. I can tell when I'm definitely taking a little pot shots from too far away. I was playing some Inferno. I played a lot of Inferno this week, and you know, I realized when I didn't have special ammo and I just had the last word that I was like, oh boy, I got to get real close to people. Yeah. The main thing I noticed since you asked about the last word is that there were times previously where I might have yelled, just do your job. And I feel like it does its job pretty well now, and I can get some very fun little cleanup.
I switched to the first curse for a game last night, and I was like, I was just out of the range that it should be used at, and I was trying to hit this person, and I was getting what should have been, like, either at least a body shot. It just was not registering, and I was like, "Yep, I am too far."
Mm-hmm.
So, just adjusted and got a little bit closer, but it feels right.
I'm curious to see how that plays out. I mean, my favorite gun from the past couple of months, no question, has been Eos Luna. With a range booster, seems like it covers a pretty effective range so that I don't feel like I need to use a sniper rifle as my secondary and can use my crispy fusion instead. I'm curious to explore those, in particular, those really high-range hand cannons and see if that's still the case or if that damage drop-off has really, really started to hit them too.
Yeah, and just another note on auto rifles, I feel like my doctrine was still whittling them down. I definitely didn't get any nice and easy melts from farther away than I'm used to. I also don't use one with counterbalance. I have one with hidden hand, and I find that gun is still usable. You know, I haven't got a chance to really try out the medium impact. I don't know if there's been enough changes to primaries to all of a sudden make those the gun you need to have. But if you really like Doctrine, I think you can really like Doctrine and also not be putting yourself at a disadvantage by using it.
Yeah. I mean, I'm still seeing a little bit of Doctrines. I'm still seeing Hawkmoon, even though that got a slight reduction to its stability as well. But with any patch notes, we got to give it more time. You have to give it more time because what you're seeing initially, like if I were to go out that first day and just play the Crucible and everybody got the patch notes and they know what changed and know what's going on, you're not seeing a genuine try by everyone. You're seeing people being like, oh, this changed, I'm going to try this. I'm trying this out because it used to be good. And you're not getting the best of everyone. So I give some more time before to balance out before we really figure out what's going on.
And when it comes down to it, the best part about patch notes is that we get to bug some developers next week who are going to come on and, you know, explain the reasoning behind this. And when we talk to those guys, I'm super excited to not only ask about the current state of Hunters and the Crucible right now, but also how they've seen it gone in the past year and where they see it going, because we've got this cool future ahead of us of the Rise of Iron. We have these unnamed Crucible features coming, and that could be really cool. And maybe we'll try to convince them to tell us something regarding that. Either way, there's so much to talk about beyond just these patch notes, and it's really awesome for us to deliver some new interactions with the guys making it, because I think that always, always opens up our eyes and the listeners' eyes to new angles, new ways to approach something, new understanding of the game. I don't think we've ever done an interview where it's not just like, wow, that's something I as a player don't think of, and why I am, you know, sitting here playing and not the guy making it. Either ways, I'm excited.
So send us your questions. We want them. send them on Twitter. You can email them to us, crucibleradio@gmail.com. And please, please, please keep an eye out on the playbook. We'll probably have a thread where you can specifically ask questions.
Pro tip on the questions thing, the most level-headed and thought-provoking questions win. We will try to, to totally clarify, we are not journalists. We don't do this to dig into Bungie and find out why they lie. We do this to further our understanding of the game. And if your question does a good job of furthering everyone's understanding of the game, there's a good chance we'll ask it. And that's what we're really looking for, because this can get very interesting and I'm sure we'll have so much to talk about. But we do want to be giving a voice to everyone who has who's generally curious.
Some of my favorite questions are the total left field ones, the kind of questions that catch everyone by surprise. Yeah, trip mines have changed, but think about the effects those could have on other parts of the game.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see if we can we can stump the Crucible balancers. It's always fun. Well, be sure to tune in next week to hear those guys tell us all about it. But show's not over yet. We're going to go deep. We're going to perhaps go the deepest into deep, deep detail of what it means to get good in this game with our guest coming up.
The deepening.
The deepenating.
Do we have enough eucalyptus?
He goes through quite a bit of it every day. And I think this is coming up right now. Mikey's favorite song. Avera. Check them out. It's Instagram.com/AVERAHTX. Texas. Lubbock, Texas. Anyways, if you're a musician and would like to be featured on year two of Crucible Radio CR2, send us an email. It's CrucibleRadio@gmail.com. Can't wait to hear from you. Welcome back to the show. Joining us today on the show, we've got a very special friend of ours, a guy we've known for quite some time, Keen Koala, a.k.a. Lime Punch, if you're on Reddit. Welcome to the show.
This is the part where you say hi.
Oh, hello.
That's staying in. Andrew, you leave that in.
Yeah, please leave that in.
Welcome, buddy.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I barely don't listen to the show. Not quite familiar with the process.
I'm just, I got butterflies. That's all.
Fair enough. Well, you came on my radar as a playbook poster pretty early on with some really quality posts that, to be honest, were a little long and I didn't read at first.
Well, I didn't expect very many people to read them at first.
A lot of dedication.
I would say my reaction to your posts were like, look at this asshole just writing a fucking novel every week. And I'm like, I'm not going to read that.
To be honest, you came on my radar when we did some state of the subreddit rules reminder post and a bunch of people started complaining in the comments and there, fighting the good fight, picking them to pieces bit by bit with carefully worded insults was Mr. U/Lime Punch. And I thought to myself, this guy's got promise.
Yeah, my insults have always been very carefully worded.
But you don't hold punches. That's for sure.
I don't like holding punches. That's right.
No, just fully punch. We tagged you with Reddit Flare asshole, and you've been off
to
the races.
I feel like I lived up to that name
since.
So far.
Yeah, but hey, you've got some credentials. You've got some real deal credentials.
Yeah, I want to make it clear that we didn't bring on a person because we like that they're just an asshole. There's some thoughts behind it, and what it amounts to is a mentality about gaming in general, competition in general, and more specifically Destiny that we admire, and it's helped me in a lot of ways, your posts and writings.
Well, I mean, let's do the spiel that we normally do. Keen, how How'd you get into gaming? What did you do before Destiny?
This segment, can we actually start calling it what it really is? This isn't anyone's background in gaming. This is, why are you such a nerd? Tell us.
What games were you obsessed with before Destiny? And how are they like Destiny?
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you always been this way, or is this a recent thing?
All right. So I guess from the beginning, I started playing video games when I was about 4. We had a TurboGrafx growing up. I don't know if you guys know what that is, but it's the alternate version of the SNES. And I played a game called Newtopia, which was like almost a mirror of Legend of Zelda. And pretty much since then, I've been really into RPGs. Destiny is actually my first person shooter that I got into. I'd played like Halo and a couple other games for the story, but never got into the multiplayer aspect of it. Primarily, I got really hard into competition in high school. I did sports. I was a cross country captain. I wrestled. I played football for a year. I ran track. I played soccer pretty much my whole life. So I've always been like really, really competitive. I have 2 younger brothers, and you know how brothers are, always butting heads.
That'll do it.
Yep. And then enough people called you a jock, and so you said, I'll show them.
Well, I always joke that people that knew me as a jock joked that I was a closet nerd, but really I was just a closet jock to the people that I was close to, because I primarily spent most of my free time playing games and being competitive in non-sport, really. After school, when I went to college, I got into Magic the Gathering from one of my roommates, and I got very competitive with that. Tried qualifying for the Pro Tour and all that stuff, going to PTQs. And after that, I got into League of Legends. I got to High Diamond 1, started trying to get on a semi-pro team, and then that just fell through because I didn't want to dedicate the time to something that was really risky as far as a lifestyle goes. I wanted something a little bit more stable, be more of an adult. I'm a little bit older than the Destiny crowd. I'm 27. So as far as competitive gaming goes, as far as competitive gaming goes, I'm kind of on my way out compared to most people.
My time is limited, you're saying.
We're like running backs.
Yeah.
As soon as you hit 26, you're done.
You're out. You're done.
It's all over. But, so what got you into Destiny?
A friend of mine actually got me a beta invite, and he was like, hey, I'm going to play this game. I didn't own a PS4 or anything at the time. I've primarily been a PC gamer. So I was like, all right, sure, I'll check it out. And I had a PS3 at the time, popped it in, tried it out. I was like, oh, this game's pretty cool. You know, seems like it has an okay story as far as like how it's being told and stuff. And of course I didn't know that the little bit that they gave us at the time was pretty much all I was going to get.
It's like a good fourth of it.
Yeah.
But I ended up buying a PS4 about a month after it came out and did everything PvE, all the raids and all that stuff. And it wasn't until House of Wolves came out that I got into PvP. I was just kind of getting bored with the game, and I had never really tried to do the Crucible. But that competitive itch got me. I was like, oh, you know, I want to get into this. I'm watching these players like streaming, and I was like, I could do that. That's how I normally get into things. I see someone doing it, I'm like, I could do that. I could probably do it better. So I just go for it. And
King,
pretty much since then,
very alike.
Pretty much since then, I've just been doing primarily Crucible. It's a complete, I just turned everything on its head.
Well, let's start at the beginning. At least as far as I know, you really kind of made your splash in the playbook with a book club. The first book, an obvious choice, being competitive and also a huge nerd, you led the playbook community through a reading of Sun Tzu's The Art of War.
Yeah, that was a weird project for me because I initially had always wanted to read it, and I finally got around to getting the book. And I was just a baby guardian at that point in the Crucible. And I was like, you know, I'm pretty good at relating things that don't matter to things that might matter to me. So let's just marry them together and tell everyone about it. Maybe they'll listen to me, maybe they won't. But I figured after seeing everything on the playbook that no one had done this sort of like deep dive into the philosophical and tactical standpoint of getting better at a game. Most of the things that I saw in the playbook were like, how do I get better at sniping? Oh, go run in a circle around the Ember Caves, or, you know, pre-aim and all these mechanical things that as you get older, and something that I've started to notice, you just can't do it as well as, you know, the young lads. So the thing that keeps you relevant later on is really just getting those things you can do with your mind that you can't necessarily do with your body. And that's outplay people, move around the map better, predict where people go, understanding concepts in the military, such as flanks and fronts and what that means for you as a player, and then marrying that up to using that information to actually get better at the game. So that's where that was the premise of the whole Art of War series. And it was fun for me because, as you said, I'm a big nerd. I'm a big intellectual, and I love thinking about things. And it was a great opportunity for me to think about things and then discuss it with other people. I was fully prepared for being completely incorrect in my analysis. And I had hoped that if I was incorrect, that these posts would give me an opportunity to learn from other people, maybe more knowledgeable than me, either in the game or just they've read the book before and have a different interpretation. So it was really selfish on my part. I was really doing it for myself.
There you go. Well, so now's your chance to pay your dues. Share us some of the ancient wisdom of the Art of War and give us an example of how that could apply to a game like Destiny.
So there's 12 points that I got out of each of the chapters of the Art of War, and I recapped it. The week one was flexibility is key. It's really important, both in the game and in life, to be flexible because things aren't always going to go the way you want them to go, and you have to be willing to adapt to still be successful. And if you can't do that, then at some point you're gonna hit a wall. You're gonna have a ceiling that you're gonna hit, and you can't get past because you're so set and stubborn that you can't change to find the solution that you need to. The second chapter I pulled out, calculated aggression is paramount to victory. If you watch any kind of competitive sport or game, almost everything that they have in common is that the winners are aggressive. And there was an analogy that Maniac Greek explained to me in poker, where you have two different styles. There's a tight aggressive and there's a loose aggressive style. And those are the successful ones in poker. And that's playing tight is like playing the numbers, playing the odds, expecting certain cards to flip. And you can translate that into Destiny, how you expect certain people to move into 50-50 sniper lanes. So you know, hey, this is where their head is, and I can push very aggressively to that point, and I can pre-aim right where their head's going to be. So when they pop around that corner, it's a free kill for me.
Wait, I thought you say stay in one place, wait roughly 5 minutes, and then when someone does walk in front of your scope, that's when you pull the trigger. You're telling me that's a calculated and well thought out device?
Yeah, that can be very calculated. Hard scoping can be calculated aggression, but obviously there are downsides to hard scoping, and I think hard scoping gets a bad rap because a lot of people do it because they think it's the right thing to do, but they don't know why it's the right thing to do.
My favorite thing on stream is to find someone who's hard scoping too much, and I like just sneak up on them or come up behind them and just voop them.
Yeah.
And as I do it on stream, I'm just like tra-la-la my away. I'm going hard scope.
Yeah, I always yell at people when I'm playing that they're living in their scope, that they've just set up a tent and they're hanging out in their scope, not knowing what's going on around them.
See, I like in your description that the first kind of component to doing this correctly is that you have to have some knowledge of what your opponent is going to do. Like everybody is run to one of the sniper lanes in Pantheon and just kind of set up because like probably someone's going to run through this lane at some point in the near future. And if they do, I want to be ready. And that's very different from knowing where somebody is, knowing what they're thinking, knowing what move they're going to make, and just taking the moment to prepare for that by getting your scope in place.
Right. Yeah. And then it becomes like every trials match is interesting because it's a lot like chess, where there are certain moves and counter moves you can make as you play the match, where you can maneuver in such a way that you can trap them in a corner, which is always the goal, right? It's always the goal to put yourself in an advantage. And so, I mean, the Art of War was perfect for that. I think my favorite point that I made later on was about flanks. The idea of a flank is that you're only a flank when no one notices you. As soon as someone notices you, you're no longer a flank. Even if you moved in a pattern that you got behind them, if the whole enemy team turns and faces you, you're what's called the front, which is what a lot of people are familiar with. And if you're the front, then you have to act like you're the front. You can no longer act like you're the flank. And this was a concept that came naturally to me, and it's probably my strength as a player, is that I'm very good at flanking because I understand like things like my escape routes or where my cover is or how the enemy team is going to attack me from where they are. And I have to be able to process that quickly so that way I can make a good decision on what I need to do next. And it's something that I harp on a lot. And I started a, I guess it's like a radio show, a stream show for gameplay critique called Crucible Bootcamp. And in it, I basically break down someone's gameplay and down to the fundamental issues they're having. I basically ignore any gunplay or mechanical issues that they're having, because obviously most people that see that in their own gameplay can do it themselves. But my goal really is to do what a lot of sports teams do, and that's look at the tape, figure out where you're going wrong, and then tell you how to fix it. And hopefully you go out and fix it, because I can't do that for you. I can just look at it and point it out to you and say, hey, man, you shouldn't be going there. You shouldn't be double peeking that sniper lane because you got domed, and then you got domed again. And then the third round, you went to the same spot. Oh, what happened? You died.
I can maybe guess.
You also kind of, when we opened up the Slack, you were the first to start begging us to put a gameplay critique channel in there. That's going pretty well too. Like you, even if you're not using it on the on your show, you're taking some time and looking at people's gameplay and kind of giving them like a rundown. And there's other people in there as well, but like I've seen you that like so much, just like paragraphs upon paragraphs, just like writing out what someone did wrong and how they could improve their match.
Right. And I'm really doing this for two reasons. The first one is I love being actually stimulated. Oh yeah, the money. But that comes later.
First that's you get actually, the khakis.
That's an interesting
then
part
you get
it,
the Slack.
But yeah, I love being intellectually stimulated. So I'm like, all right, you know, I begged you guys like, hey, because I was constantly in the tower chat room, and people would post, you know, what am I doing wrong? And then I'd go in these long, you know, page long explanations of what they're doing wrong, what they can do better. It was about that time that I realized, hey, I have something here. Like I can do something about this. And I talked to Bobbles, and he went to you guys and worked it out, just because I didn't want to take away from the point of the tower, which was basic discussion. I wanted that in-depth discussion. I didn't want that to override anyone's like, you know, minor questions about whatever they had. So it was really nice to have that channel up. And then I basically used that as a jumping off point for my show, because I realized there's a lot here that I can't convey over just text. I wanted to show it. So I actually, on the boot camp, I bring up maps, mostly Orion's maps because they're wonderful. But if there isn't one available, then I'll bring up a different map. And I have a whiteboard program where I'll draw X's and O's and be John Madden and scribble all over the board and show you actually what it might look like to do certain plays, or to what it looks like to make a flank on, say, Frontier versus a Burning Shrine, or where the head glitches are, and actually point it out on the map and why it's good to be there, why it's not.
We want to talk about the full process of the show in a little bit later, but I do want to get back to the book critique and the book club that you had on Crucible Playbook, because that's really, you know, the first thing you need to do, I think, before you can even start thinking on your game on this technical level and, you know, receiving feedback and adapting it is figuring out your mentality going into playing. And you broke down a book called Playing to Win by David Serlin, which many people know as a video game book that discusses fighting games and the actual meta and the competitive elements of fighting games. But you applied that one to Destiny as well. And that one stuck out with me so much on your first post. I want to talk about introducing the scrub, because that's easily my favorite post on the playbook. And it should be required reading for anyone who wants to get better at the Crucible.
I think it's probably my favorite thing that I've ever written, like, period. I had so much fun writing this article and conveying a tone that is pure sass that
I would say that is pretty accurate.
I don't think I could ever recreate this. I don't think I'll ever be in the right mindset to recreate this, because there's just a perfect storm of events happening on the playbook at the time. But yeah, it's basically a fighting game community article on a mindset for a scrub, which by Sarlin's definition is a scrub is a player who is handicapped by self-imposed rules that the game knows nothing about. A scrub does not play to win. So the key phrase in his definition is handicapped by self-imposed rules. And you see this everywhere. And with
I can kind of relate to it, because before I started getting into the Crucible, I was a scrub.
Yeah, but, that's true.
But like,
this is a safe place, Swain.
I would give my friends shit for using Thorn, and I was just kind of like, that gun is like too good. Why are you using it? Like, why are you being one of those guys?
Yeah, it's a moral superiority complex, basically. The scrub just has a moral superiority complex. It's like, hey, you know, I'm not using Thorn. And I beat you, therefore, and I deserve to beat you because I'm not using Thorn. But when you use Thorn, you don't deserve to beat me because you're cheap. You're using something that's unfair, or it's leveraged against me, or whatever excuse that you want to come with that the game doesn't care about.
That gets disguised in so many ways, too. You know, it's one thing to say, I don't use Thorn because of my morals, which is, one, a stupid sentence, but... two, not how it's always phrased. I mean, I see people reacting to patch notes saying, that takes no skill, which is, one, a stupid thing to say, and two, it doesn't matter, because, you know, it's just your way of saying, oh, you use a more effective tool than me, yet I expect to have just as much success against said tool. You know, so there's
in fact, I deserve the success.
Exactly.
I should have had it had you not cheated and used that gun.
Had you not made a decision that I'm capable of making myself, I would have won. Had you put yourself at some other random and arbitrary disadvantage. So there's a lot of ways to apply this mentality without even maybe realizing it yourself. And that all comes with, what are you really placing the blame on? Your decisions that you made or what another player did?
Well, the best example of this as a disguised, being a disguised scrub is actually the mindset that you're playing for to have fun, but you get upset when you lose. And so that is like the definition that I'm going for here for a scrub, because if the point of the goal and the ultimate end game of what you're doing is winning, then anything you're doing that doesn't get you to that point, it's inefficient. It doesn't matter. Like, you should be doing, if the point is for you to win, then you should be doing whatever it takes to win outside of cheating. Cheating is always outside of scrub mentality. It has nothing to do with playing to win. It has everything to do with just pure manipulation. But the idea that you want to have fun, but you still want to win, you can't get upset when you lose. And you're trying to have fun, because in a playing for fun mindset, the whole point is to enjoy yourself, to enjoy the time you're spending. But when you suddenly get upset because you're trying to enjoy the time you're spending, but you're losing, then really your whole goal was never to have fun. Your whole goal was always to win, but to have fun while doing it. And those are two things can be at odds with each other, which a lot of people struggle with that. Like, winning isn't always fun, but it can't always be fun winning.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think that's one thing that, I got that. I think one of the best examples for me is playing with No Land Beyond and a sidearm, which is a lot of fun. It's hard to do. Essentially you're handicapping yourself quite a bit for the vast majority of players, but when you get in the groove with it, it really is enjoyable. But if you go into a lobby and you choose to use No Land Beyond and a sidearm, and everyone else is playing with exotic hand cannons and fast firing auto rifles and whatever the sort of meta flavor of the day is, and accordingly, they do a lot better than you. They come out with the win. They come out on top of the leaderboards. That doesn't mean that you can't play with No Land Beyond and a sidearm, but it means you have no expectation of winning or of criticizing any other player for not choosing to play by these rules that you've picked up. There's not anything wrong with it inherently with wanting to say, let's just play some control. I don't care what the outcome is. You know, let's goof off.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's like I'm on a diet right now and I'm eating nothing but Soylent rice and vegetables. I can't just go downstairs and get mad at my roommate who's eating chips and Mike and Ike's right now, because that's his decision and I'm capable of making it if I want to feel good. But, you know, it's just it's another person's decision and it's out of your control. And yeah, some things aren't as fun to play against. But you know what? Nothing's fun to play against because all guns hurt you and kill you.
That's right. That's right. And the reason like I bring up the playing for fun thing is this is something I actually learned when I used to play competitive Magic, because when I started playing competitive Magic, I picked all the decks that were super fun for me. I played really bad cards. I just wanted to do silly things, and I didn't really care that if I won or not. I just, you know, wanted to do ridiculous things. And as I got more and more into the competition and wanting to get on the Pro Tour, I struggled with the idea that I had to play the meta deck, that I had to play the what was considered either the best deck or a deck that beat the best deck. I wanted to win on my own terms, and it was hard for me to accept that my own terms sometimes has to be picking what's good in the meta and just dealing with it and chugging through it, because if I wanted to win, I don't necessarily have to have fun while I'm doing it, but I still want to win. So I just, mm-hmm. you just pick what's best. So in Destiny, a perfect example of that, what it used to be is you either picked Thorn and a shotgun, or you picked the Last Word and Sniper. And when that was the meta, when I started playing, I picked Last Word and Sniper because I just, shotgunning just didn't appeal to me. And now that after all these patches and all these changes, I've taken up a shotgun every now and then, but mostly I've brought a fusion rifle into play, and it's, in my opinion, it's on the cusp of like being good enough to be a competitive choice, but it's just not quite there yet. And there are a lot of reasons for that. And I personally, I don't think it'll ever get to that point because of the inherent nature of the charge time. But that's a good thing because it allows counterplay for your opponents, which I think with a lot of these patch notes and the way the game has gone, that Bungie wants counterplay to different things that you can do in the game, which in my opinion is perfect. There should always be a move and a counter move you can make to either nullify what your opponent's trying to do or to soften the blow.
I feel like fusion rifles, if they go any further, will be way too like there's it's a steep ledge that they're sitting on right now. You know, if they go any further and get any more stable or any more range, you end up with something that's way too overpowered.
And we're going to be hearing all the time about how fusion rifles are cheap.
Yeah,
yep.
It's kind of getting there right now. People are starting to pick them up a lot and realize that they can be very powerful given certain situations. Like when I was discussing with the Battle Bros when they were creating their guide, they were like, you know, well, how do you use your fast charge fusion rifle? And I was like, well, I have knee pads on mine, and I figured out that the slide time from when you start charging to when you stop charging is the same as your knee pad slide. So I can use it like a shotgun. And you guys have discussed that before, but that was a workaround for some of the weaknesses that fusion rifles had. And it's still a huge weakness because I get outgunned by shotgunners left and right. A fusion rifle using knee pads just can't outgun a shotgun. You'll trade at best because of the shotgun's instant. It's that, then that's what's holding back the fusion rifle. It's not instant. You have to plan for it. And so that skill floor is really high already, and the skill ceiling is capped because there's time between when you start wanting to fire and when it actually happens. And that's something like it's hard for people to accept that like there's a hard ceiling on it in its current state. That's not to say that it won't change in the future, but we're not in the future, so we have to play what we have with what we have right now and just deal with it. And that's the reality of it. So Serlin has some ideas on different styles of players, and they primarily came from chess grandmasters, which was very interesting to me because I never really got into chess. So it was interesting to see that a lot of the play styles that you see everywhere can be boiled down to how chess grandmasters played. And so there's a few examples, but to break it down, there's a turtle. There's which is super defensive. And there's a, I don't remember the name of it, but there's someone that's really aggressive, like hyper aggressive. And then there's somewhere in between. And philosophy has an interesting concept between pure reason and then and logic and then pure emotion in temperance. And it's kind of in philosophy, that's where you want to be. And it's sort of like Nirvana, you know, you understand both sides, and that's kind of where you want to be as a style of player. You want to get between defensive and offensive and knowing when to turn that switch on. So Sirlin goes into every single, player archetype. And you always want to strive to be what he calls the one true style or the beast. His example is Daigo Umehara, who is like an absolute monster in the fighting game community, specifically in Street Fighter. And he's been around, oh gosh, for 20 years, I'm pretty sure. And so when you achieve like the one true style and you become like basically the god of the game, he would call you invincible or the beast. And that's sort of where everyone should strive for. Obviously, not everyone is going to be good enough. There's a concept called Dunning-Kruger that the Dunning-Kruger effect, where, you know, most people are average and there's a bell curve, you know, everyone's falls somewhere along the middle of the bell curve. And some people think that they're better than they are and they're really not.
Well, I'd be better if other people weren't using Thorn.
Yeah. I mean, it would be so easy if people just didn't use what was good, right? If everyone used a Hakon's Hatchet, sorry to people using Hakon's Hatchet, but if everyone used it, yeah, you would probably be a god. But as the fact of the matter is, people that want to win use the best. You got to compete with the best. And some people just aren't cut out for it.
I'm on this podcast to influence everyone to use crappy things so that I appear better.
Yep. Save those for the montage.
Yeah. Well, secretly our plan all along.
Okay.
One thing I like about all those different play styles is that I think one of the criticisms you get about really committing to playing to win at any cost is that, oh, well, you're just using kind of the same cookie cutter build as everyone else. When really that's the least important part of it. You know, there's so many different approaches to winning in how aggressive you are, like you say, how defensive you are, how unpredictable you are. That is incredibly diverse. There's a lot of pathways to kind of finding that one true style where it's really, you know, you're a chameleon. You're sort of whatever the moment needs you to be, that it doesn't matter that you're using an exotic hand cannon or any other gun.
Right. It's because the game is dynamic. So unlike chess, where there are certain moves that you can make and there are certain moves that you can't make, and it all ultimately ends up being restricted by the board. If you think about Destiny and the map is the board, it's dynamic in that you don't play on a flat space. You play up and down. You play around corners. There's things that you can do to manipulate the odds into your favor. And so it's fascinating that this sort of dynamic play is in this game. I that's really why I do it so much, is because every game is going to be different. No matter what your loadout is, you have to play around certain things in the environment and certain maps. And your opponents are always going to be different. There's always going to be that human element where maybe you play against players that always do the wrong thing, but because they always do the wrong thing, what you consider to be the right thing is actually incorrect. So if it's always right to avoid the 50-50, but your enemy opponents are only staying around in the 50-50, the right thing would actually be to go to that 50-50 and challenge them because you know you're better than them, or to manipulate them in such a way where you always get a flank because you know where they're always going to be.
Wow, that's some nerd shit.
Yeah, yeah, it is.
That's actually a really, really cool way to look at things. Is you know, it's not just about going out and doing the same action. Like, oh, this is the best strategy. I will do this action repeatedly, and I will win. It's about adapting in the moment. And we talk about adapting so often on this show, but I feel like oftentimes we're thinking long term, or we're thinking, you know, a wide amount of changes has been made to the game. You must adapt. But adapting is an immediate thing that has to happen constantly. Because if someone switches up a style on you and you are just only prepared to counter one thing, you're done, because they are going to outplay you. So adapting has to happen on the fly, and it's a tough thing to do.
It is. It's very difficult.
That's why I carry, like, you know, three different scout rifles with me, a pulse rifle that I like, a hand cannon, and all of that is in my primary slot, and then the secondary slot. So, like, I'll adapt to the map. I'll adapt to my opponents. And you don't want to be stuck in one, you know, one set of weapons, because then you will end up on Anomaly. And all of a sudden, your scout rifle, sniper rifle loadout isn't the best.
Right. I brought up a couple acronyms that I use on the show that I've been doing. Two in particular. One is ABC and the other is TAR. ABC is always be checking. So you always want to check what your abilities are and what's up and or not, and your radar, where people are, what's going on your screen. And then TAR is think, act, react. So we've been talking a lot about reaction and or being proactive. So think about what you want to do and what it's going to look like when you get there. Act on it. Don't just think on it. So you go there and then react when you get there. Is there a person there? Do you have a shot on them? Do you not have a shot on them? What do you do next? And then you just repeat the process over and over again. That's how you should play every match if you want to win. Obviously, if you're just playing to play, then you don't need to tax yourself and burn yourself out. But if you want to get into a playing to win mindset, you really have to have that foundation of what do you actually do to win? It's not just about having the right loadout. It's also about thinking how a winner would think and thinking about how best to get those percentage points against your opponents and get that first shot off and be able to flank or be able to push when you need to push or pull back when you need to pull back. And that all takes time and experience. Like, you can't just teach someone, you can't just show someone in 10 seconds the proper way to push, because that's always going to change based on, you know, what's going on the map or who the players are or what your loadout is. There's just so many things that you have to take into account that will only come with time.
Kane, let's talk a little bit more about your show. I know you got something big coming up that I know Birds is probably really excited about. He's been talking about
it
forever.
I'm really excited for it. I'm really excited. I didn't think anyone would actually pull it off, but please, Crucible Bootcamp.
Okay, so the premise of Crucible Bootcamp is it's a gameplay critique stream. So I live stream. Someone sends me in. They'll email me their footage, and I always take non-sixes because there isn't really much to say about sixes. It's just you hold a zone, you wait for people to walk into your gun. There you go. That's six. But playing, what I primarily focus on is threes and rumble. And both of those have, the four different game modes that I critique are all very different in the kind of advice I can give you. And you guys have had plenty of guests over your year that talk about, you know, skirmish, salvage, rumble, trials. So I'll look at their gameplay. Normally I'll review it twice outside of the stream, take some notes on it about some fundamental things they're doing wrong and some fundamental things they're doing right. Because not only you don't want to just break someone down, you also have to be willing to lift them up. It's really easy to remember your failures. But when you get reinforced for what you do right, and I have a dog, so positive reinforcement is super important. When you reinforce what they do right, you're going to make it a habit. You're going to do it over and over again. So if I reinforce that, hey, you know, you're pulling at your sniper at the right time, you're going to go back when you start playing these games where you're focusing on things that, hey, you know, I'm confident that I'm going to pull my sniper out at the right time. And then you can work. You don't have to worry about it anymore. You can work on what the other things you need to know. So like maybe you needed to work on your radar, your radar awareness. Maybe you needed to work on little things like how to jump properly or sliding more around maps or how to challenge a sniper properly or how to bait shotgunners into traps. Like, and I'll point these things out on the stream and their gameplay. And then after that, I'll pull up a map, the map that they played on, and then do sort of a ESPN John Madden breakdown where I'll show, you know, X's and O's. You can move here. You can do this.
So you're kind of good at the touchdown for the Packers to go up 6 points. You gotta get a touchdown like that.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what I do.
I just want to see some like old man mumble about Destiny for half an hour. It's like, so the thorn is pretty good right now, but the last word is with the accuracy. The thorn, it's more accurate because of the accuracy buff.
Yeah. I'll take these gameplays. I'll spit out, you know, what they need to know. I'll tell them, hey, this is what I would like to see you work on. Whether they work on it or not, that's out of my hands at that point. They came to me for advice. I gave them advice. It's up to them to do something with it. But what I realized before doing this is that there's no one in this community in particular that does this on an actual, like, scheduled basis. I know that over my, you know, year and a half on Playbook, there have been things that come up every now and then, like, hey, you know, let's critique what you're doing. And there's a gameplay critique sticky on it, but it isn't as in-depth and personal as my show is. And we talked about earlier about money. I actually have ulterior motive for this, and that because no one is doing this, and this game, if Bungie wants to get into esports, they need shoutcasters, they need analysts.
Woo!
I want to do this. Like, I would really, really be interested in being an analyst and doing color commentary, because I would be awful at play-by-play, but doing color commentary and really breaking down, like, why things work and how they're working and what they're doing right and what they're doing wrong, and see that in a way that a lot of players will never see it, really, because a lot of people that aren't in competitive gaming don't really think like that. They just, you know, it's fun. They don't need to think about what it actually takes to win. They just, you know, play the game, enjoy their time, and move on with their life.
Well, I'm going to have to pick my very best recorded match to send to you, so you'll be impressed, but or have just fewer things to pick apart. One thing you mentioned is how you bring up the maps and really dive into them.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to gloss over that, because the first couple times I saw your show, I was really amazed at the level of map knowledge that you show and that you kind of show is necessary to really succeed at this game. I mean, the reality is we play these same, you know, two dozen maps over and over and over again. And, you know, I'd done like the exercise that sports psychologist Steve said, where you close your eyes and you mentally just navigate your way around a familiar map.
Yeah.
But I don't think that even begins to kind of scratch the surface of just the level of understanding of angles, for example, that you can put into any one of these maps. Can you sort of talk about kind of where people can go who feel like they understand the maps pretty well, they sort of know the routes, but want to go to the next level?
Yeah. So, concept of angles is something you hear a lot from sweaty players, all over the place. And it's the idea that, you have, the ability to go to a location where you get first shot off on an opponent. That's the basic definition of it. And so the idea of a good angle is one that you either have to move to, or one that someone has to move to you, to sort of create the situation where it's good. Obviously, if you take the example of hardscoping, if you're on Pantheon and you're on the long waterfall lane, an angle would be, you know, you peek out in the middle of the lane and you can see all the way down the lane. So now you have an angle all the way down on the other side of the lane. But if no one shows up, then you have no angle and you're not covering anything, and that's bad. Even though you know that that's a situation where you can get a kill, it's only a situation if you get a kill where someone comes and shows up. In the same way that if you know someone is spawning, let's say you're on Twilight Gap and you're on A point, you know someone is going to spawn on C fence. So knowing that, you can get an angle by going up into party room, out into mid, and sniping or shooting with your primary down fence line. And that would be moving to an angle where you predict where the opponent's going to move to, and then you go there and you punish them for moving there. And that's sort of the mindset you have to get into if you're going to take it to the next level. Like, you always have the foundation of callouts. If you don't know your callouts, then you should definitely find the Orion maps and just absorb them in
available
your
at cruciblecom.
Yeah. And just memorize them. And while you're in game, whether you're by yourself or with other people, if you move to a location, say it out loud. Say, you know, I'm in A, or I'm on B boxes, or I'm on shelf, or I'm on the head glitch, and get that vocabulary going. So you're always thinking about that. Hey, where am I? Hey, where are they? And then, so after you get your foundation, then you go, okay, if I'm here, then, and you know where they're going to spawn, or say it's trials, so you know there's only certain ways they can move around the map. You just move there and you stop them from doing what they want to do. the easiest way to win the game is to stop your opponent from doing what they want to do. So if you think your opponent's always going to go to the 50-50, you stop them from going to the 50-50, and then they're going to run around like chickens without their heads on. Like, they're going to be confused. They're not necessarily going to be comfortable with doing that. And you see that a lot in the early trials rounds, is when you go to the 50-50 and you shut that down, you make them scared to go to it. Most people, they do what? They hide in their spawn and they wait for you to come to them. And when that happens, now you're playing your game. Now you get to go to them and you get to engage them on your terms. Or you just never have to engage them and wait for them to come to you. You can play point. You don't have to do anything if they're going to be scared and stay in their spawn. You can just sit on the point, wait for them to come to you, and kill them when they get there. So it's this push-pull where if you want to get to the next level, you have to get into the head of your opponent. Because if you're at the level where you have good foundations, then you as a player are solid. Like, you know what you need to know. Your gun skill notwithstanding, if you can always get the first shot off, you're always, and you can always give yourself an advantage in a situation, whether that be utilizing cover or getting vertical, then the next thing you need to do is think about, hey, where are you going to move to? And if you don't move there, where are you actually moving to? And if you go there, what do I need to do to stop you? Or where am I going to finally meet up with you and get in a gunfight? Is where I'm going to meet up with you in this situation good for me or bad for me? And if it's good for me, I should go there. And if it's bad for me, how can I turn that into a situation where it is good for me?
Well, Keen, this has been pretty darn fun. but I want to know, I want you to tell everybody about what you got coming up. You got something exciting that you're about to do on your stream. And give them the places they can find it, too.
All right, so the big thing that I came up with is it's a normal 3v3 critique, except I got footage from all 6 players. So my critique is actually going to be a breakdown from all 6 different points of view of plays and kills and pushes and everything. So you'll be able to see exactly what a team can do right and what a team can do completely wrong and get punished for it. I've been practicing basically with side-by-side YouTube videos and everything and syncing them up and seeing how I would actually critique this and show what needs to be showed. But I'm really excited because this is something that no one's ever even attempted to do. And just the thought of it is just kind of melting my brain. Yeah, it's very daunting and it's been really hard. I've already spent probably 6 or 7 hours preparing for it, watching all the things and trying to jot notes on what the plays I actually need to bring up are on the different videos. So it's daunting, but it should be really, really informative and really show you the power of getting angles and the power of outplaying your opponents and knowing where they're going to move around the map. As far as where you can find me, I'm on Twitter at Keem Koala. If you want to send me gameplay, as long as it's non-sixes, I will critique it. You can send that to keenkoala@gmail.com. That's 3 or 5 E's. So K-E-E-E-E-N koala@gmail.com. And then I stream at twitch.tv/keenkoala. And every Thursday at 7 Pacific and Saturdays at 5 Pacific. Those are when the boot camp episodes are live streamed. And then everything afterwards is edited down and then put up on YouTube. And that's Keen Koala. And there's a playlist for all the boot camps. So if you want to get started, 1 through 6 will be up there. And number 8 will be the 6v6 or the 3v3 6 point of view one. So I'm really excited for that.
Go watch that dope montage you just dropped.
Yeah.
Toothless. Yeah.
Definitely check that out.
That's sick.
All right, buddy. Well, thank you for coming on. A lot to get through, and I encourage everybody, go watch the stream, go check this out, try and digest some of this stuff. We're definitely going to have to keep talking about this and kind of keep focusing on the more in-depth side of really breaking this game down. Keen, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me, guys. I feel the
we even get to all the great new chroma they put into the game. Green?
Wait, what?
I'm gonna have to get so many new sets of armor so that I look good.
There's new chroma.
Uh-huh.
We got patch notes. We got class changes and weapon changes. You got other stuff too?
Yeah, there's some pretty good stuff kind of thrown in here.
Oh, okay, this is what I get for leaving. I'm never going to do this again.
Well, Birds, you can actually take a photo of your guardian on your PlayStation, and then by pressing the share button, you can send that picture to Twitter.
Oh, snap. What? I'm going to make so many more tweets. I already thought it was
going to
make
maximum show.
Tweets.
Send your tweets to Crucible Radio Fashion Show. Hashtag Crucible Radio Fashion.
I don't know if that's a thing yet. Make it a thing. And go check out our website, please. It's cruciblradio.com.
Yeah.
I'm loving it.
You can literally find everything there. You want to know how to get in the Slack? Go there. You want to hear some great, awesome tips from Bones about trials matches? Go there.
It is literally the hub of the space internet, is cruciblradio.com.
It's the center of the space universe.
We had the space inspector come out and certified us earlier this week. Exact center.
Woo!
All right, guys. 24 hours. I'll be back. We can play some Destiny.
Can't wait.
Bye, guys. We love you.